Hello, it's Keith here, and welcome to another assembly programming tutorial. We've been looking at various sound processors over the last few weeks, and this week we're going to look at the SN76489. Now this processor is used in the Sega Master System, the Sega Game Gear, and also the Genesis and the BBC Micro, and that means this week's going to be quite a special lesson because we're actually going to be looking at three different processor types as well as four different computers. Now, to be honest, the Game Gear and the Master System are almost the exact same computer, but never mind. When it comes to the Genesis, it does actually have a superior sound processor, but we're not going to be looking at that this week. We're going to be using the backwards compatibility of the Genesis to the Master System to use the Master System's simpler processor because it's enough for what we need today. Let's have a look at the theory of the SN74689 processor. Well, the SN74689 uses a single byte and it receives that byte from a single port on all of the systems. So we're just sending one byte at a time, and the content of that byte will define the command that the processor actions. Unlike most of our systems, we don't have the register and data structure. The bytes contain the commands and the data all in one. So let's have a look at the basic template of a command. Well, you can see it just here. So of the 8 bits that we send, the topmost bit is known as the latch bit. This will be 1 for the first command or 0 for the second command. But in effect, we actually only need to send two commands for tone commands, which set the pitch. Next, we have two channels. Now, the sound chip has 4 channels in total. 0 to 2 are the tone channels, and number 3 is the noise channel. The next bit is the type of command. There are two types. A 0 will set a tone, will make a sound effectively, and a 1 will set the volume for that channel. The remaining 4 bits will be the data that is passed on, and that will vary in functionality depending on the rest of the command. So let's have a look at a few commands. Well, the first one is the first part of a tone command. So the latch bit is set to 1 because it's the first command. The channel will vary, but it will be 0, 1 or 2 because of course 3 is the noise channel, which takes a different kind of command. 0 will be the type because we're setting a tone. And then we have 4 low bits of the tone. We need a second command. The latch bit will be set to 0, and this means that the tone channel is unlocked and will start playing when this command ends. Then we have 6 high bits of the tone channel. So these two together make up the tone, and the higher number is a lower tone. Well, we're making our tone, but how do we set the volume? Well, this is a single command, so we can just set the latch bit to 1. We don't need a matching 0 bit. We have a channel again, this time 0 to 3, because the noise channel 3 is set in the exact same way. The type is set to 1 because we're setting the volume. And then we have a 4-bit volume from 0 to 15, and 0 is the loudest and 15 is the quietest. Noise channels work in very much the same way. We have the latch bit set to 1. The channel can only be number 3 because there's only one noise channel. The type is 0 when we're setting the type of noise, but we can also set the volume. So this command also applies to noise channels. We then have a mode. If it's set to 1, we have white noise. If it's set to 0, we get a very synthetic electronic noise. And then we have a rate. 0, 1 and 2 will be various pitches, and 3 is a special one. And what that does is it links the rate of the noise to tone channel 2. And this is our most flexible option, because what we can do is we can mute tone channel 2 and use its frequency setting here to define the rate of the noise. And that's what we're going to do today when we write my Chiba Sound driver. If you've not followed the previous episodes, what we've been doing is we're writing a program called Chiba Sound, which is a very simple single byte command function that takes that byte and it makes a tone from 0 to 63 in a 2 possible volumes and with noise on and off. So it's very simple for making beeps and distortion effects for games. And this is what was used in Grime Z80. So that's the theory of the data we send to the processor to make the sounds, and we'll look at practical examples of that in just a moment. But we do need to know a little bit more, because when it comes to how we actually get the data to the processor, it does vary depending on our system. So on the Master System and Game Gear, for example, the sound processor is connected to port 7F in hexadecimal. So we just write our byte data in the format we've just described to port 7F, and that will work. And in fact, this will also work on the Sega Genesis if you're using the Z80 processor. Unlike the Neo Geo, where the sound could only be accessed from the Z80 processor, on the Genesis we can access this sound processor from the 68000 as well. And because we're doing very simple sound effects, we don't really need the processing speed, so we're just going to use the 68000 to do all of the work. And to do that, we write to memory address C00011. This is the sound chip, and the data we can send is identical to the Sega Master System and Game Gear. The only slight exception is I've noticed the noise does seem to be quite a bit lower pitch. So I've had to change the noise commands because they were so low you couldn't hear them. And I think that's to do with a random number generation within the VDP on the Genesis. The BBC Micro, which is a 6502 based system, is almost the same again. Now on the BBC Micro, the sound chip is actually connected to the keyboard and joystick I/O, so we need to do an extra command. What we need to do is we need to tell the I/O processor that we want to write out to the sound chip, so we need to set all of its bits to write. And we do that by writing 255 to FE43, because a bit 1 will set that bit to write. From then on, we can just write the data in exactly the same way as we did for the Z80 and the 68000, and we write it to a memory address FE41, which is where the actual sound chip is. Finally, when we finish sending our sound data, what we need to do is send bit 4 set to 1 here to FE40, and then all the bits set to 0 to FE40. These commands are required on the BBC to send the data to the sound chip properly. So a little bit more tricky for the BBC Micro, but not too bad. That's really all there is to it. So all we need to do is work out the command bytes we need and then send them to the right port depending on our system. Very straightforward. So I think it's time for some practical examples. So here's the code we're going to be using today. We're going to make a variety of tones and sounds, and then we're going to look at writing Chibi Sound. So first of all, let's hear this little tone we've got here. So we're using channel 2, because you can see here, that's number 2 there, and we're setting the volume here. And we're setting the volume to maximum here, because this is 0, which is maximum. And we've got a kind of mid-range tone here, because we've got a 1 here in these high bits. So let's hear that. So that's fairly high, but we can go higher. As I said before, lower numbers are higher tones. So if we put that 1 there, now it's much higher. But if we move the 1 further along the other white direction, now we have a lower tone. But we can, of course, change the volume as well. As I said before, higher numbers are quieter volumes. So if I set a 1 here, we'll get a much quieter volume. And there we go. So that's how we can use our tone channel. Very straightforward, really. But we don't have any envelopes on the Game Gear and the Master System sound processor, so we can't change the volume over time. We would have to do that with our processing power rather than the sound chip doing it automatically. So let's just ram all of those out. And let's bring this code into play, which is going to allow us to have a play with our noise effects. So let's start with the rate set to 0 and the volume set to maximum here. And you can see here, this is channel 3, which is, as I've said before, the noise channel. So there you can hear there's some fairly high-pitched noise, relatively speaking. If we change the mode to 0, this will give us some more electronic. We just change that back. Now we can do 3 very basic noise frequencies. So if I change this to 1, you can hear it's a bit lower pitch. If I change it to 1-0, which is 2, lower pitch again. And finally 1-1 will now link us into the tone channel. So for this, we need to re-enable our tone channel up here. But we don't need the tone channel to actually make a sound, so we'll set all the volume bits to 1, muting the tone channel. So now our frequency of our noise is being linked to the tone channel. So what we can do is we can change the frequency of our tone channel here, and the noise gets higher pitch. Noise effects now. And there we go. So you can hear there, we've got a lot of flexibility with regards to the pitch of our noise, and that's what we're going to be using in our Chibi Sound driver. So, well, what is Chibi Sound? Well, if you've missed out on the previous lessons, we've been writing this on all of our Z80 systems, and in the future we're going to write it on all of the 68000 and 6502 systems we're going to cover. This is a command which takes a single byte and then uses that byte to make a constant tone. The pitch isn't quite the same on all the systems, but a low tone is always a low tone. A distorted tone is always a distorted tone. And the format of the byte is NVTTTTT. So the topmost bit is noise on or off, one for on. The volume bit is loud or quiet, one for loud. And then there's six bits of tone, and the lower the number, the higher the pitch. So there we go. So let's hear it in action. So you can hear here we've got some noise starting up, and as the values go lower, the pitch gets higher. And then once we get past C0, it will start again, but it will be slightly quieter this time. And so this is our quieter noise. When we get to 8-0, we'll start into the tones, and the whole procedure will repeat for clear tone effects. And so you see, this gives us very basic sound effects for our games, and this was used in the Grime game, and I'll probably use it in some more little games in the future, just as an easy way of getting basic sound effects into a game without lots and lots of platform-specific programming. And there we go, we're now into the quieter tones. And there is one special command, 0 will stop all of the sounds. So that's enough of that noise, let's have a look at the source code. So here's the Chibi sound code, it's very short as you can see, which is what we want for such a simple function. So first we check if the byte is 0, if it is we jump to this silent, and all it does is it sets both the tone and the noise channel to volume 15, which is muted. Next, we set the low bits of channel 2 to 1, because we actually don't need those. And then we get the rightmost 6 bits of our command byte, which was passed in the accumulator. And we set the high bits of tone channel 2 in this second command with the latch bit to 0. And that will start the tone. Now what we need to do is set the volume. So we've only got one volume bit here. We shift it to the right until it reaches this point here. And then we send it to the processor as the volume for tone channel 2. But what we also need to do is mute tone channel 3, because that's the noise channel. We do that now. Next, what we do is we check if the noise is supposed to be playing. If it's not, then we're finished. If it is, then we actually need to mute the tone channel. We did need to set the tone channel, because we're using the tone channel to set the frequency of the noise. We do that now by setting these bits to 1 here, which sets the rate to be linked to tone channel 2. Note, there's no way to set link to tone channel 0 or 1. You have to use tone channel 2 for this function. And then finally all we do is we pull back in the bit that we shifted over here, and this time we use that bit to define the volume of tone channel 3, which is of course the noise channel. So that's really all there is to it for Chibi Sound on the Z80. Okay. Well, I did promise you we were going to look at it on a few other processors, didn't I? So let's do that now. Now, we're not going to go into very great detail on the 68000 processor at this time. This is just an example series on the sound chip itself. There will be a full series of 6502 and 68000 programming tutorials starting next year on my channel. So if you want to see that, please subscribe, because I can assure you it's going to be good. So here's the Sega Genesis version of Chibi Sound. Now you can see here this is a 32-bit value here, and that's because all the registers on the 68000 are 32 bits wide. Now, so only just looking at these ones, you can see as the number increases in the exact same way as on the Z80 processors, the sound will change accordingly. Now the noise is very slightly different, because as I said before, I had to reprogram it a bit because the Genesis noise is slightly different. This version of Chibi Sound isn't trying to make the sound effects identical on all the systems, so the frequencies, the A, B, C, D, E, F and so on, that they aren't going to match. That was outside of the scope of what I was trying to do at this time. I may do a more advanced tone perfect version in the future, but this was just something very basic so that I could start writing games with sound very quickly on a lot of systems. So how does Chibi Sound work? Well, surprisingly, I actually converted the Z80 version to the other ones, so you'll find that the code is very similar. So first thing on the 68000, we wanted to get rid of any waste information from the first register. We're using D0 instead of the accumulator. All registers on the 68000 are numeric, so D0 is the first one. So we just want a single byte. We check if that byte's 0. If it is, we go to this silent command here, and what that does is it mutes both of the channels, channel 2 and 3, the tone and noise channel we're using, by setting the volume to 15. And as I said before, all of writes are going to C00011, which is the sound processor on the Genesis. So once we've got past that, what we do is we back up the register, because we need to do various commands to it. And so the first thing we do is we set the low bits of tone channel 2 to 1. Then we get the 6 bits of our passed variable. which we use to set the high bits of tone channel 2, and that will make our general tone. We then need to get bit 6 here, which is the volume bit, shift it along 4 bits to the right into this position here, and we use that to set the tone as before. Then what we do is we mute the noise channel and we check if the noise bit is set. If it's not, then we jump to the end here and we just finish the program. But if it is, we need to do a little bit more. So as I've said before, the noise does seem to be different on the Genesis. So what I've done is I've split the 6 bits into 2 halves. I'm setting some of the low bits here and I'm setting some of the high bits here. So a little bit more tricky, but nothing too complicated. And then what I need to do is I need to mute the tone channel and then set the noise linked to channel 2 here. Finally, I load back in the volume that I backed up over here, and I then use that to set the volume of the noise channel here. And that's really all there is to it. So that's not too difficult. The advantage of the 68000 is that I can do a lot more in single commands here. But I know if you're used to the Z80, it probably looks a little bit confusing at this time, but don't worry about it. As I say, really at this point, all I was trying to explain is that basically the procedure is the same, just the port is different. So we will have a look at 68000 assembly in the future. So what about the 6502? Well, let's have a look at that now. So here's the byte that's being passed to the Chibi Sound driver. And you can hear that the noise is changing as the byte increases, as before. Well, that's enough of that. I think you can take my word for it that it works. Let's have a look at the code. So again, the procedure is basically very similar. The first thing we have to do is we have to set the BBC's I/O port so that all of the bits are set to right. So we've done that there. Next, we check if the accumulator is 0. If it is, we go to this silent command here. And again, as before, we set the volume bits of the noise channel and the tone channel all to 1, muting both channels. If it's not muted, we back it up into the X register here. And then we set the low bits of the tone channel to 1. Then we get it back from the X register here. And we get the 6 bits that define the tone. And we use those as the second command to set tone channel 2 here. Now we get the volume bit, which is the 6th bit, and we have to shift that to the right. And we do that with this rather tricky command here, which effectively shifts us 1 nibble to the right. We then use this EOR command, which is an XOR command, and we flip all the bits and we use that for our volume. Finally, we mute the noise, and once again, we check if the noise is enabled, and if it is, then we carry on. If it's not, then we jump to here where we're finished. Finally, what we have to do here is we have to send the commands to the sound chip, and then we just stop the sound chip from processing here. This is a special finishing command for the BBC computers. Now, if we do need to make a noise, then what we do is we mute our tone channel. We then set our noise to use option 2, which links to channel 2. And finally, we get back the volume that we backed up into the Y register here. And we do a similar flip command here, but just on a different channel. You see that was channel 2 and this is channel 3. And that's really all it takes for us to get our tone working correctly there. So again, as I said before, it's very straightforward. Really, there's not too much different, apart from the assembly commands are slightly different, of course. The actual procedure of playing the sounds is the same, and the bytes and their effect on the sound are basically the same as well. Well, there you go. I hope you've enjoyed today's lesson. We do have another episode next week on the beeper speaker, which is used by the ZX Spectrum 48K. Very basic sound effect system, but it's the ZX Spectrum 48 is very popular, so we do have to support it, but it's very, very limited. But we're still going to learn how to make Chibi Sound on it. And even if the 48K Spectrum isn't really very viable as a sound system, it's quite curious the procedure we use for it and the effect that what we do has on the sound. So hopefully you'll follow me for that, and it'll be quite interesting anyway. I hope you've enjoyed today's lesson. Please like and subscribe to my channel, especially if you want to learn when the 6502 and the 68000 series start next year, hopefully in January. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed watching today. Thanks a lot and goodbye.